As the great Yondu once said, he might be your father boy, but he ain't your daddy. Humans adopt other humans sometimes, taking in those we're not genetically related to, and that's a great thing to do. But in the animal kingdom, things start to get weird, like interspecies adoptions, or ones where it's not really wanted by at least one participant. So from lions to monkeys, let's look at the weirdest cases of adoption in the animal kingdom. Ever done that thing where you've picked something up and then you completely forgot why it's in your hand? Well, don't feel too embarrassed. Some animals do that too with each other. First on our list, eagles of the genus Haliaetus have been found to occasionally rear the chicks of other raptors successfully to adulthood. Raptors referring to birds of prey, not the villains of Jurassic Park. Researchers were monitoring a nest of white-tailed sea eagles in the Czech Republic. To their surprise, they also found a healthy common buzzard chick. And a month or so later, that chick had actually fledged earlier than its giant adoptive siblings. Checking the literature, the researchers found several other cases of this happening, including ones where the buzzards fledged successfully. In bald eagles, there are multiple records of similar events happening with red-tailed hawks, and even a seagull in one case. So what gives? The scientists believe that the eagle parents snatch other large bird chicks from nests as food for their own young. They regularly do so with herons as well as buzzard chicks, dead or alive, at different ages. But when the eagles got the various chicks back to the nest alive, they sort of forgot they were there for eating? Eagles are solitary nesting species and don't have great social skills, so it's been suggested that the eagles were very poor at actually recognizing their own young, so they thought the stolen chicks were their own offspring, not takeout going bad in the fridge. Some researchers have even taken advantage of this phenomenon. Some European conservation programs have used raptors as foster parents to raise rare Spanish imperial eagles and lesser spotted eagles. So, a happy ending to get the ball rolling. Eagles aren't the only ones coming home with extra family members, though. Next on our list are eastern screech owls. An 11-year project in Texas looking at both species found their worlds colliding when the researchers found live blind snakes in the owl nests after the chicks had fledged. At first, they thought the snakes might have climbed in by mistake since they're known to climb the rough bark of oak trees in search of ants. But then they actually recorded the adult screech owls bringing the live snakes back to the nests and the snakes being alive the next day. Screech owls normally kill prey before they ever bring it back to the nest. And when the team surveyed the nests, they found almost 20% of the 77 study nests housed one or more live blind snakes. So it did actually seem that this might be a deliberate act, and it wasn't just random chance. But as is often asked in science, why? Well, it seemed the whole thing was a win-win for both parties. Seems like the snakes were snacking on unwanted insects in the nest, even eating so well that one female snake was able to reproduce. As for the owls, owlets raised in nests with blind snakes had better survival rates. Fly larvae can parasitize and kill baby owls. The chicks also had faster growth rates than those without the snakes when scientists compared the two, leading to higher overall breeding success for the parents. It's hard to say how much the owls know what they're doing, as we can't just, like, ask them, but it's suggested this may well be a deliberate behavior by the owls to keep nests clean and chicks healthy. To go from the air to the sea for our next entry, in 2014, an unusual case was seen by scientists monitoring the bottlenose dolphins in French Polynesia. One, a mother had two calves, already uncommon, and two, one of them was actually a melon-headed whale calf. Barely a month old, if that. The researchers don't know how exactly the baby whale wound up with his foster mother, but he really took to dolphin life quickly. For 4 years, he was raised in the pod, socialized with the other dolphins, was seen to engage in dolphin-y behaviors like breaching, and even bullied his adoptive sibling out of nursing sometimes. After 2018, the little whale wasn't seen anymore, so his eventual fate was unknown, but it does seem he got a solid start in life. The why of the adoption is hard to say. One suggestion suggestion was that the inexperience of the mother may have led her to make unusual decisions. Her natural calf actually went missing in the observation period too. On top of that, she was also noted as a very curious and sociable individual, often approaching and interacting with the scientists on dives. So it could be that a lack of knowledge and her uniquely friendly personality led her to take in the little whale calf. After the adoptee was no longer seen, the mom had a second natural calf. So fingers crossed they grew up okay and didn't think they were a whale. Now before we get to the rest of the list, all science needs funding, so let's go to a quick break. Thank you to Planet Wild for supporting today's SciShow video. Planet Wild is a community-based nature protection organization. Think of it as crowdfunding for nature. Every month, their community of more than 14,000 members funds a new project to bring back endangered species, protect our oceans, or restore forests. Planet Wild documents all their projects in videos that you can find right here on YouTube, so you know how your contribution has helped protect the planet. This is a solution-oriented and hope-filled alternative to climate anxiety, and it puts you in connection with a community of people who care as much as you do. As a Planet Wild member, you can support a variety of projects from the comfort of your couch. Like this year, they backed Indigenous Guardians of the Amazon to protect the forest from logging and fires. Planet Wild also helped save seahorses in Sydney by building special underwater hotels and planting seagrasses, so these tiny sea creatures have a safe place to live and grow. To join Planet Wild's growing community and support projects like these, just become a member. You can give whatever amount feels right to you and start for as little as the price of a sandwich. Every dollar counts in protecting nature, and there's no catch. You can cancel anytime. The first 100 people to sign up using the code SCI11 will get your first month prepaid. Just scan this QR code or click the link in the description. If you want to see Planet Wild in action, check out their project Saving Seahorses in the link in the description. There's already been a lot of surprises on this list, but this one might take the cake. Lions don't get along especially well with, well, anyone, but especially not with other carnivores. So when a lioness in India's Gir forest was seen with a leopard cub, it was quite a shock for the researchers. Other studies looking at relationships between lions and leopards have found lions are way more likely to kill leopards than raise them. In fact, in one study, they were found to be responsible for up to 20% of deaths in both cubs and adults. Similar behaviors have been witnessed by researchers in the Gir forest, but our lion Ness wasn't playing that game. Rather, she treated the leopard like one of her own, alongside her three natural cubs. She allowed it to suckle and feed from kills, and the cub happily played with its giant adoptive siblings for as long as the researchers observed them. So once again, the why? Well, for a start, Asiatic lions are less social than their African cousins, so there's less chance of the cub being killed by the lioness's pride mates. And importantly, lions and leopards belong to the same genus, so there's likely some overlap in signals and behaviors that may have led the mother lioness to think the leopard was another lion cub. It was also her first litter that made it more than a few days, so once again, it could be the lioness's inexperience that caused her to scoop up the extra cub. This also isn't the first time it's happened, and in Tanzania, a similar but far shorter and less well-documented case of a lioness and a leopard was spotted in 2017. A lioness in Kenya was even seen to adopt oryx calves in the 2000s, but this case never underwent full scientific scrutiny. For the Gir leopard cub, sadly, things were not to be. A few weeks after the first observation, it was found dead by a waterhole. Autopsy found the cause to be a congenital hernia, so he probably never had much chance. But for his short time on Earth, the little leopard got to think he was the king of beasts. For number five, we head to Panama's Jicaron Island. A long-running study was already in place there after it was found that the white-faced capuchins on the island were seen to use tools, which is always catnip for scientists. But then the scientists saw one of the sub-adult male capuchins doing something quite weird, carrying a baby howler monkey. The same male was then also seen to carry around three more howler babies over the next few days, taking them around with him until they presumably all perished. Then, after a pause of about 5 months, the rest of the boys joined in too. Several other young males joined in with the howler carrying, sometimes even swapping the babies, who were often trying to escape. Hard to blame them. The group started taking incredibly young babies too, even repelling the adult howlers trying to save their young. So less adoption and more abduction. And this is a real problem for the howlers. They're already a small, isolated island population, and none of the babies are believed to survive being taken. Something that makes the why of this case hard to answer is the fact that the perpetrators were all male. Male capuchins play a limited role in parenting, so it's probably not misplaced motherly instinct. Rather, the best suggestion the researchers could come up with was, well, boredom. Like, no, really. Hikaron Island has no predators or competitors for the capuchins, and an abundance of food for them. It's believed this may lead to understimulation, a lot of free time, and essentially the evolution of boredom. And the young males seen to carry the babies are the ones most often innovating new behaviors to alleviate that boredom. So, howler monkey baby dolls, apparently. Luckily, not all primates are such bad foster parents. We are great at it. And I'm not even talking about adopting our own kind. We have a lot of species we've adopted over the years, if you count everything we've ever kept in a zoo. But for this entry, we're concerned mainly with wolves, or dogs, or the wolves we turned into dogs. How humans did this is a bit of a point of contention, since they very rudely didn't leave notes for us. Some sorry excuse like writing didn't exist yet. Originally, it was suggested that wolves came to human settlements to scavenge scraps and became progressively used to people until tameness and domestication ensued. But newer theories refute this and suggest something different, that we essentially started adopting wolf pups to raise ourselves. This is corroborated by indigenous peoples around the world. Indigenous Americans were seen to play with wolf pups at their dens, and Aboriginal people in Australia do the same thing to tame dingoes for their camps. There's only a short period during which wolf pups can become socialized to humans, so for domestication to occur, it seems like humans would have had to target pups around that age. But the two theories of domestication aren't mutually exclusive. It could have started with adoption, resulting in tame, semi-wild wolves having their own pups progressively closer to camp. Eventually, they could have just moved into human settlements and started breeding there, and proper domestication began. For the why? Security, hunting partnerships, and as many of us experience today, companionship. Lastly, we must turn to the shady world of organized crime. Because our final example is someone being forced to rear someone else's young. In this case, great-spotted cuckoos forcing magpies and crows to rear their chicks. Cuckoos are pretty famous nest stealers, so you might be wondering what's different. Well, magpies are pretty bright and nest predators themselves as well, so you think they wouldn't fall for seeing the wrong egg in their nest. And it seems like they don't. So the cuckoos make them an offer they can't refuse. Rear our chicks, or we smash up your nest. When scientists removed the cuckoo eggs from the magpie nests as an experiment, they found the cuckoos actually returned to destroy the nest. They believed this provided an incentive for the magpies to rear the chicks by imposing severe costs if you don't comply. But it's worth noting, unlike some other cuckoos, great-spotted chicks don't roll the eggs or hatchlings out. They do hog the food as expected, but the magpie chicks normally survive. And like any good mafia boss, they even sweeten the deal. The cuckoo chicks excrete a smelly material when a predator visits the nest to put them off, and this protects the magpie chicks as well. In areas of high predation, it's even beneficial to have a cuckoo chick in the nest. It's basically a mob protection racket, and there, like, actually is protection if you pay up. So there you have it, our list of the weirdest adoptions in the animal kingdom. Sometimes it works out, sometimes not so much. But what's incredible is the behavioral flexibility at work in all these animals. We get to learn about something we never thought they would be able to do. And also, mafia birds. We also get to learn about mafia birds.